Russians and technology does not go kind of do not go well together. Yeah. Well, my name is Yuri Maltsev, and I'm right now from People's Republic of Wisconsin, but previously I lived in the Soviet Union, which definitely was a place really too big to fail, but failed miserably, being completely destroyed by its own government without any outside help. And, well, it was outside help to save that government, but that's what they did. It was 11 time zones. It was bigger than truth, the country was. Can you imagine that Soviet Union was bigger than United States and Canada 2.5 times? So you combine United States and Canada, and Soviet Union was bigger 2.5 times than that. There's 11 time zones, 1/6 of the world's surface. And that disaster called socialism completely destroyed that country. I have a pretty bizarre background myself. I was one of economic advisors to Gorbachev's government. I wasn't the advisor, I wouldn't take the blame. And nobody listened to my advice, and look what happened. And then I defected in the United States in 1989, and found myself working for the second largest bureaucracy of this planet, for the federal government in Washington, D.C. Well, the word work and government does not go together well. Working for government sounds like an oxymoron. And so, in about a year, I thought that I should do something positive in my life and moved to Wisconsin, and I'm teaching young Americans ideas of freedom, ideas of free markets, free minds. So this is the most, and it's great to be here with you, because it looks like that's the only place right now where the people of liberty can congregate together. Today is a very sad day, just exactly the same time. United States Senate is considering a new immigration bill in which the national ID card is buried. So with biometrics, with everything. So then DNA arrest is also, that means that DNA will be collected for any arrest, for speeding, for whatever else. And so it's all buried. I'm not a great fan of any president, but Attorney Mises, maybe you remember, Attorney General of the United States was Ed Mises for President Reagan, was once at the party at his house. Also, it was interesting that he was stereotyping, because I never met him before, so I was invited to party at his house. So when I rang the doorbell, he opened the door and he said, "You must be Mr. Russian." I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "Wait a minute," and he disappeared. And then he returned back with a huge, oversized flower vase and gave it to me. And I was thinking, what's that for? And I smelled it. It was full with vodka. It was probably a gallon of that stuff. And if I would drink it, I would just die there on the welcome mat. And then he, but he told us an interesting story that there were some hotheads in the Republican Party in 1982 who wanted to introduce this national ID card. And Mr. Reagan had even a meeting in the National Security Council on this ID card. He was 10 minutes late. He was 10 minutes late, so that was a bad sign, So he came 10 minutes late, and he said, "Well, this is just the report. It's like about 400 pages about this national ID card. I have a very simple proposition. You just tattoo a social security number on the forehead, and the picture is updated daily and everything, and very difficult to forge it. And on like that." So the people just, the NSA people and National Security Council people, they just stood up and left. And that was the end of the national ID card at that time. So now we don't have anybody who can do that. And so the liberty is being attacked all the time. So what I would like to introduce today is a fantastic video made in the Republic of Latvia. It's a video called The Soviet Story. And really, the Soviet story it is. Amazingly enough, that the video was funded by the European Parliament. It's just, they probably so stupid that. And so the video was made by Edvin Schnorri, a young Latvian film producer. And it's based on archives. It's a fantastic video. But just before that, what if I will, because not everybody is disturbed by good knowledge of Marxism. And so what if I will do a little introduction just for you to kind of like to digest this video, maybe and kind of a little bit better prepared. So Marxism, what is Marxism? Sorry, this is the wrong Marx. This one. So, Karl Marx was a German philosopher, an economist who ceased to be economist and philosopher and became just an apologist for mass murder. He came up with the idea that you need to have communist society, which should be standardized in 400 or 500 years from his time. But in between, we should have a big government, which is called socialism, and socialism would prepare us for communism. So those people who say that, for example, many of my colleagues would say, well, socialism is actually good, communism is bad. This is completely wrong, because communism was never practiced anywhere. And when you talk about Communist Party, that's the goal is reflected in the name of the party, not in actual kind of policies. So that's... At first, there should be a socialist revolution. And the revolution should eliminate private property. Because private property, from point of view of Karl Marx, is theft, is a tool to exploit one person by another. Bourgeoisie will fight, revolution will be violent. A dictatorship of the proletariat will follow to ruthlessly weed out remaining capitalist elements. So he was proposing mass murder from the very beginning. He wasn't a humanist or whatever people are trying to portray him. Utopia, however, the communist utopia is just would come in 300-400 years. And people will be free to choose how they labor and can be creatively productive. They will be able to live to their fullest potential. The state would wither away from his point of view. So that would be some kind of communist anarchy would descend on us, communist anarchy. Many comrades during Lenin's time, when Lenin introduced Marxism into real politics, they were still thinking that. And Lenin usually would call capitalists useful idiots. Capitalists who would support socialists would be called like Mr. Soros, for example, in the United States, or Warren Buffett. He would call them useful idiots because they have money. But communist anarchists he called useless idiots. And his point was that exactly for them, the telephone poles were erected. Means that you should just hang them on telephone poles. So communist utopia is kind of like a carrot before the masses. So Marx wrote, in communist society, nobody has one exclusive sphere of activity, but each can become accomplished in any branch he wishes. To hunt in the morning, fish in the afternoon, rear cattle in the evening, criticize after dinner, without ever becoming hunter, fisherman, herdsman, or critic. So that's this wonderful society which should descend on us in 300 or 400 years. Well, there was a Ludwig von Mises, who was the first economist and the first Western intellectual who immediately saw through this Marxist utopia and its implementation in the Soviet Union. Just half a year after the socialist revolution in Russia, already in March of 1918, he wrote a short but very powerful essay, Socialist Calculation, Economic Calculation of the Socialist Commonwealth. It's a fantastic little essay which was written at the time of the communist revolution in Russia, but where he saw the imminent end of that experiment. His point is that it's not a working system, that socialism is not an economic system. It's a simple system of commands, simple system of management. People work not because they're interested in that, not because they have incentives to work, but because they're told. So they are told to do that. And sure enough, the people in the Soviet Union at first were the very nice people. I mean, if you will look at the Soviet, today some people would say, well, look, a lot of my students would believe that look, our president or people around him are very nice people. They would never do something wrong. So that's exactly how first Soviet government looked like. First Soviet government was the government of intellectuals. Trotsky was writing poetry in French. Lenin knew six languages and could play piano very well. Everybody else was like that. But then the logic of introducing and forcing on people this system turned them into horrendous mass murderers. Horrendous mass murderers. we will save this maybe for, we'll have a little bit more time. But these are the leaders of the first leaders of the Soviet Union. So you can see Stalin, Lenin, and Trotsky. It was the famous troika. Lenin, Trotsky looked like one of my students. And Stalin doesn't look like my student, but he did. So that's the logic of the system, which turned them into mass murderers. I am working in the Library of Congress from time to time because I got a little grant from my university to study something called Volkogonov archives. Dmitry Volkogonov was a general of the Soviet army and commander of the Soviet Institute for Military History. And he was a propaganda person, he was worse than Rachel Maddow for me. I mean, when I would see him on TV, I would switch him off right away. He was just a professional liar. And I'm sorry that I hated him, because I didn't know that since 1980, he bought a Xerox machine in Austria, and he was making highly illegal copies of everything going through his desk. And what went through his desk is just horrific. It's handwritten memos, mostly by Lenin, by Stalin, by Khrushchev, by Gorbachev. It's just amazing. He would be, if they would know what he's doing, he would be shot right away without any trial, without anything. And he collected 46 boxes of these materials. And so when he was, then when Soviet Union collapsed, he became National Security Advisor to President Yeltsin. He approached the US ambassador and said that he has this treasure. He wants to move it to the United States. Ambassador said, okay, agency will help you. He said, no agency, meaning CIA. He said, no agency. Library of Congress, that's where I want to put it in. And so now in Library of Congress, we have this fantastic material of 10,000 different papers, different copies. And it looks like I'm the only one who is actually using them, because so there's the CIA, who they probably don't have reader's cards or whatever, so they don't go to the Library of Congress. But materials are horrendous, and you will see the same in this video. Materials are just, Lenin, for example, that also gives you an idea of what socialism is about. Lenin, in 1922, he's writing to Trotsky, "Dear Leo, I'm telling people what to do, nobody listens, I'm tired of that. What if we will take a couple of these absent-minded comrades and shoot them publicly?" And they did, and people began to listen. And the more they shot, the more they listened. In 1937, that was the most murderous year of the Soviet history, they were murdering people with a speed of 20,000 per day. That was a meat mincing machine which worked with no rest at all. At that time, amazingly, in 1937, Bob La Follette, governor of my state of Wisconsin, he visited Moscow, returned back to Madison, Wisconsin. He said, "I saw the future and it works. I saw the future and it works." And I'm very much afraid that this future...
Works for
can make it work. I was thinking that what I was listening to a previous speaker, and I really liked his presentation very much. However, I would disagree with him completely that he said that left-wing people, they want to help the poor. They don't want to help anybody. They want to acquire power. Power, that's what they're looking for. And then there's an excuse, you can use poor, you can use whatever else you can find in using. The socialists in the Soviet Union also came up with the idea of helping the poor, helping the deprived, and whatnot. It ended up in mass murder, the mass murder of immense proportions. These are the numbers. This we'll talk about it. Soviet Union, perfect killer state, 61 million people murdered of all nationalities. They had special system of extermination camps. This is the map of extermination camp, going through all 11 time zones. Communist China, People's Republic of China, they murdered 78 million people. In North Korea, a relatively small country, over 2.5 million people murdered. Yugoslavia, which is considered to be kind of a nice place, over 1 million people. So von Mises was talking about two types of socialism. Next time, I have like three lectures here. So we'll talk about, we'll just have more time for the movie. And so that's why we should all time keep in mind that they declare that the people usually are not stupid. The governments are not stupid. They're mostly evil. When I met Sam Francis, was the first one I heard it from. Sam Francis was a great philosopher and economist and writer. And he told me, he said, Yuri, we have a two-party system. One party is stupid, another evil. And I said, who are you? He said, I'm none of the above, but I am close to stupid. I said, he voted Republican. And so that's, but you can, they're interchangeable, I think. We have a bipartisan party today. So this is the greatest tragedy, that people are being caught like fish, charmed like fish, by these wonderful slogans of equality, wonderful slogans of helping the poor, that's why the best society in the world would be society which would be a product of human action and not of human design. So that was the major idea of Ludwig von Mises, of all Austrian School of Economics, and Friedrich August von Hayek. He put it in a very nice, versatile form. And Hayek was a triumph of Hayek. Oh, sorry, that's the wrong Hayek. So, this is the true Hayek. And he is looking at the at the corpse of Lenin in mausoleum. And sure, this is a picture from Vilnius, Lithuania, after the collapse of Soviet Union, and Lithuania was part of Soviet Union. I visited with my students, and they have this park of fallen foibles. And that was an interesting monument, other monument, which I couldn't take a picture because there was so much against it, so I couldn't take the picture. But that was, I think you will trust me, that there was one entrepreneurial Lithuanian. There was a lying monument to Lenin, and he put a little bridge over, and for a thrifty sum of 2 liters, about 40 cents, people could go and pee on Lenin. On Lenin. And I had a lot of very, very angry female students who said that this is another male chauvinist pig entertainment. All right, on this tragic note, what if we'll watch the video, if we can. This video has an interesting history. The effigy of Edwin Schnorrer was burned in Moscow on a red square. And moreover, the Swedish ambassador was beaten by mistake because they took her for being a Latvian ambassador. This movie was made in 2009. It won a lot of prizes. And we had a movement, quite, and I was part of this, organizing the viewing of this movie through PBS, Public Broadcasting System. But sure enough, this the socialists over there hated the movie because they love Stalin and Lenin. And their major argument was that in a movie there is not so much documentary footing of Soviet atrocities. And I, one thing I can say, there's, I think there's enough, but more than enough. But from another hand, in the Soviet army, for example, that's unlike German army, which is also kind of, they would take pictures of the atrocities they commit. Many Germans were very proud of what they were doing during the Second World War. And they had ability. In the Soviet army, the ownership of a camera is a death sentence, immediate death sentence. So nobody could take any pictures of anything. So with not much ado, what if we will watch it?
Destroy about 10% of population, and that's very specific. This is used not just to kill enemies, they're not enemies, is to restructure the fabric of society. It's a social engineering.
Marx began it. He was the ancestor of a modern political genocide.
People were being shot day and night. Stalin even got to the point of killing people by random, by quarters. I don't think the world, certainly Europe, has never seen that sort of murderous killing. The Soviet Foreign Ministry was surrounded by NKVD troops, tanks, and Stalin gave the order, clear out the synagogue.
Big hole, and then covered their shooting through the back of the neck. Each of them, the people were tied up with his hands behind, on their knees.
Of children lost their parents and became homeless, or so-called bezprizonia. Millions of them were begging for bread in the streets of Soviet cities. It was an embarrassing sight, especially if foreign friends came to visit Moscow. And Stalin tackled this problem.
Stalin authorized in the middle of the 30s, because there was this problem of bezprizonia, he authorized children to be shot from the age of 12.
People were being shot day and night throughout the biggest country in the world. Stalin even got to the point of killing people by random, by quarters.
Let's say 100,000 in Tambov district. Okay, that's it. Whoever they grabbed and shot, will be fulfilling quota. They wouldn't care about names. Then after the quotas were fulfilled, the local authorities would report to Stalin, to Central Committee, and asked for additional quotas.
Хрущев просил, что лимит вот там, что-то ему там разрешалось, что-то 7 или 8 тысяч врагов народа. Он просил, дайте мне лимит на 17 тысяч.
An additional quota will be given, and after fulfilling, they would again ask for additional quota, and so it will go in circles. It was like mincemeat machine, you know, it was just killing and killing and killing.
Сталин, как человек, у которого весь в крови, я все это видел, его резолюции, когда пачками он подписывал, вместе с Молотовым, Ворошиловым, Кагановичем, Ждановым, это самая пятерка была инициативная. Молотов всегда добавлял, заменить 10 лет на расстрел. Пачки.
И в результате вот только за эти с 37 года по 41 11 миллионов человек. 11 миллионов. Можете себе представить, какие масштабы репрессий своего народа?
And I don't think the world, certainly Europe, has never seen that sort of murderous killing, either in numbers or in nature.
There was a man in Europe who was closely following the situation in Russia, Hitler. To kill millions of people in such a short time was truly remarkable. Holocaust was as yet only an idea in Hitler's head.
Hitler! Hitler!
All right, well, I think that was a pretty impressive video, and it's a real documentary, and this video is telling us what the government can do to people, especially when they're introducing socialist ideology. There's a famous American economist, Armen Alkian. He is not even Austrian, he's in the University of California in Los Angeles. He believes that every government is a socialist institution. That every government, it's a matter of degree, not a matter of quality, a matter of degree. So from his perspective, government should be very small. From my perspective, it should be zero, zilch, zip, nothing. But, and you can see what governments can do to people, especially the socialist system. I would say it's a system of public slavery, of socialized slavery. And which was even more, I would say, more horrific than the system of private slavery. Because under private slavery, it would be insane to kill your slaves. In public slavery, they don't belong to anybody. People would be considered a liability, not an asset. And so that's why, moreover, they created the regime of. And that was the nice people in the beginning, looking like Borat or writing poetry in French. That they created a system of the total terror. Total terror was that you kill people randomly. Not because whom you are, whatever, but by some unknown pattern. So nobody could modify their behavior or do something to remain alive. And I think that it's also a warning for us about our Second Amendment rights. Yep. Because definitely the people who were very much in gun control were Stalin and Hitler and Lenin, They disarmed people. Can you imagine 7 million Ukrainians? Would they be just waiting to die like that? So I would say that this is a very powerful, I think, warning for us. And sometimes I feel that our government in the United States is treating us like cattle as well. It's trying to disarm us, finding out whom we're calling or whatever. It's just unbelievable. And that's the people. I remember Dianne Feinstein, now who is kind of our fascist number one. She was a human rights activist in the 1960s.
The government that went ahead and actually liberated your people. This is the same U.S. government that you are now talking bad about that went actually in there and lived help.
No, this is the U.S. government 50 years ago.
This U.S. government, I wouldn't say liberated.
Yeah, because back then they were good, but now they're bad, as I was saying. When they were helping out your people, the U.S. government was bad. But now it's... I mean, it was good, but many.
Why was it good? I mean, no, I never said that it was good. I mean, what was good if they...
They just left your people alone and have them kill each other.
They didn't do anything for that, people.
I'm pretty sure...
Who won?
Actually, I'm pretty sure the United States had to intervene against and go against Hitler in order to help liberate...
He's from Russia, not Germany.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, then Russia.
Russia on
a... Yes, I would say that the whole idea, it was even, can you imagine, even George W. Bush, whom is not my favorite at all, he spoke in 2007 in Latvia. And the president of Lithuania, who is from Chicago, whom I happen to know personally, he told me that Mr. Bush, he said, somebody else probably wrote him speech, I don't know. He was speaking on the Victory Day in Riga, Latvia, and he said, Second World War began as the war for the freedom of Poland. And then he looked there and he said, did we win this war? Can you imagine, even he, who was not an advocate of freedom, even he admitted that. And what was Yalta? Yalta was a betrayal of all these people. Poland was given to Stalin. Stalin exterminated another 1.5 million of Poles. Every third Lithuanian disappeared from 1940 to 1952 in a period of 12 years. So that's the... And why they would apply mass murder? Because socialism, again, is not an economic system. There is no incentives to do anything under socialism. The only way to make people what you want them to do is to kill them or threaten them with murder. And that's what they were doing. And what my boss, Mr. Gorbachev, did, he inadvertently, I would say, he removed fear out of the system, which was only glued by fear. Was at that time, I remember in the Soviet Union, was a popular joke was that the CIA didn't know what perestroika is about, and they sent their best agent to Moscow to find out what's happening. And this best agent is going from one store to another. He goes to the butcher shop, writing down in his notebook, no meat, going to a bakery, no bread, going to a shoe store, no shoes. And there is a KGB guy looking over his shoulder. He said, 10 years ago, you would be shot for doing that. And he writes there, no bullets. Yeah. And that's when people realized that there are no bomb bullets. Then everybody stopped working right away. And that was the end of the USSR. So I think that we... why do they I think was one of the speakers, they're a member of European Parliament, saying that why do not talk about, why would we know, my students, for example, they know almost everything about genocide in Rwanda, but never heard about genocide in Ukraine.
I was taught about
genocide in Ukraine, oh, very good. Yeah, I think that 95% of Americans do not know about it. And what is, I think, very important for us to keep in mind, why we keep it under the lid? Not because of oil, not because of gas, as they're trying to say, but because they're socialists themselves, because they like big government, because this is indictment not only to Soviet government, but to any other government which is practicing this kind of policies. I think you had something to say?
I was just going to ask, why is it you think the Holocaust, people are so much more aware of that atrocity than this?
Because Holocaust, I think, doesn't have much kind of relation to socialism. National socialism was perverted into being kind of into portrayed, being portrayed as a right-wing ideology. It wasn't right-wing. It was as left-wing as Soviet socialism. It's the same kind of ideas. Moreover, until 1935, Hitler's regime was considered to be left-wing as well. In 1935, Stalin decided to kind of separate from them. And he was the first, speaking on the 7th Congress of Comintern in Moscow, Stalin made a point that this is the reactionary right-wing attack force of modern capitalism. Germany was not a capitalist. We will talk about that next time, about these two different patterns of socialism. National socialism, what Mises was writing about that, and Soviet type, Soviet pattern. Soviet pattern is everything is nationalized, belongs to the government. Nazi type of socialism is when property rights are declared, but they are phony. The government is telling you when to close, when to open. It's a regulatory state. It's a regulatory state. Lenin at first was also thinking that he cannot nationalize everything. So his major point was that we will build socialism when capitalists will do what they would tell them to do. So we will keep them alive. But then he radicalized himself during the, because it was pretty easy for him, and he began the same mass murder. Mm-hmm.
Yes, the Moshe Plashai, Tom Plashai, New Grafton. This might be a little off, but your comment on this subject that you made. In peaceful tranquility, relatively, in the U.S., it is said that we have the highest population prisoners, the greatest convicted people, not by only population, by per capita. Could you comment? I don't want to make any comparison to the past, and now this big push on anti or no gun ownership. Your comment on any similarities?
Well, I would say that now the occupant of the White House we have right now, I think he is a true Marxist-Leninist. He is doing, if we would have a true Marxist-Leninist there, he would do exactly the same thing. Some people on the left are disappointed that he doesn't go far enough. No, he does. He is doing exactly what is possible to do now. And so definitely, as Rahm Emanuel, his former chief of staff, now mayor of Chicago, he was, used to say that we cannot make this wonderful crisis to disappear. We cannot put this crisis to waste. We should, and what comes to mind again, Hayekian formula. Hayek used to say that to greatly expand the power of government and to curtail civil liberties of people, you need a crisis. This crisis can be real, imaginary, or fabricated. Now we have all three, I think. And so that's what they want to do. And definitely incarceration rates, right? This is again the power of government. We have 2 million people incarcerated in the United States. It's just amazing. The numbers, yes, more than anyone else.
One thing I'll never understand is why when the communist system finally failed, not just in Russia, but all over Europe, wherever, why did the people rise up? Take their revenge on the Communist Party members and the KGB, whoever.
Well, the revenge, why, the question was why the people would not take revenge on these murderers. Because in many countries they did. In many countries, for example, in Baltic states, if you're a member of the Communist Party, then you are prohibited to be in education, to be in government service or whatever. You can only work in private sector. Then in some other countries, in Germany, East Germany, they put some Stasi agents. In Estonia, they put some just unbelievable. I mean, Soviet officers shooting pregnant women into the fetus and whatnot. Just these atrocities, unbelievable. And they were all heavily decorated as war heroes in the USSR. In Russia itself, I think that Alexander Solzhenitsyn, the great Russian writer, he put it right, that they didn't have moral cleansing. They mixed right and wrong so much that people are confused. Look, they have the president in Russia today, Mr. Putin, who was an ex-KGB colonel. Moreover, he himself, he said that ex-KGB is an oxymoron. If you're in KGB, you're in KGB. You cannot be ex-KGB.
I have a quick question. Mm-hmm. So you, as a member of Russia, do you feel like the United States at some point should intervene and help out your country, or do you think we should just completely leave you out? I mean, you know, do you feel like the government in the United States should send their troops over there and help you guys out, or just leave you all to...
Why should we send our troops? No, I'm a Wisconsin taxpayer. Yeah, it's not.
Yeah.
It's not.
You've been to Russia lately. Have you seen how many people are starving there? The kids.
Why would I? We're not talking about that.
Well, have you been there before? Is that where you're from?
Yes.
Have you been there lately to your own country?
I've been to part of Soviet Union. I'm not going to Russia. My last article, published in Russian. Yeah, can I just finish? No, I don't think that we should interfere anywhere. What message we can convey right now? Yeah, what do you?
I mean, I don't know. Sometimes we go in and we bring food to you guys. You know, we have the Red Cross, all these different things that come with the military. You don't agree we should do that?
No, I don't agree with that at all, no. And but my last article, why I don't travel much to Russia. My last article published in Russia in 2000, when Putin was elected by 70% of people on more or less free elections. And my article was, a meat voted for a meat grinder. So I don't think he liked this title. And I would say life expectancy around Mr. Putin drops like a rock. If you will look how many people died just because they didn't like him, including Polish president, including his own KGB buddies and whomever else. Yeah. So this is a regime which today it's not more like Marxist-Leninist regime. It's more like a Nazi regime, nationalism. Nationalism, which is used to beef up the power of the state, Speaking about interventions, then I just don't think that we should. I think everybody is clear on this issue that we shouldn't intervene, especially today in Syria. Whatever, it's just amazing for me. I think Ron Paul was absolutely right. I was privileged to be on a panel with him at the Liberty Summit in Florida. And he was asked, should we intervene because there's so many enemies in Iran and in Syria? And he said, most enemies of the United States are within 1 mile radius from my office.
I'm from Russia, and I want to say that US government have some funding helping Russia, but most of this funding goes to Putin's friends, yes. To his party. Yes.
So, because our troops
it's
are
better,
going in there too.
Better not to help.
But that's the kind of on this cheerful tone, cheerful note we can. And I am around all the time, so you can ask me any questions or whatever.